The thought that life could be better is woven indelibly into our hearts and our brains.
Welcome to this week's Personal Empowerment Podcast, Finding Yourself in Paradise. Hi, I'm Michael Benner.
And I'm Steve Snyder. And our podcast this week is about how we figure it's never really too late to have a happy childhood. I mean, it's true, what happened happened, but even though that can't be changed, what can be changed dramatically is the way you feel about what happened then, now.
There's no reason to be cynical and say, boy, wouldn't that be nice? Wouldn't that be cool if you could really somehow go back and fix your childhood? What do they mean? It's never too late to have a happy childhood. What happened happened. Well, of course it did. And we're not talking about denial. We're talking about a very dynamic process of using the imagination in states of deep relaxation where you're feeling really safe and open and non-critical and can bring the mind of the adult you've become to something that happened or a series of incidents or some generalizations or false assumptions from childhood that upon another look from the adult point of view, the person we've become, can often create an instant healing. And with repetition, Steve, I think there's a lot of benefit. I know, we both know, a lot of benefit that comes from this. It's a very real deal.
Indeed. I mean, think of any event that happened when you were a little kid that was something that you regret or you're remorseful or embarrassed by or something that you feel ashamed about having done. You know, any event from childhood. And realize now, if you look at it from the point of view now, what you could feel is like proud of yourself for having survived that and learned a lesson from that, and instead of feeling ashamed now. So now you still feel ashamed that you did that when you were a little kid, but now you could change that and feel proud of yourself. Remember what you did. Remember that you felt ashamed then, but you actually have the power to change your mind and feel, instead of ashamed now, feel proud now that you made it through the thing you made it through.
This is a very important point. I didn't know you were going to jump to it so early in the program, but let's do it.
Well, I think it's the core.
This is very, very important. Now, think about what Steve's saying. If you feel that you've been humiliated, I mean, we all have dozens and dozens of times in our childhood, especially we're talking about between 4 and 7, that window, okay, plus or minus.
Really, really in there. It's almost always like 4, 5, 6, 7. Rarely is it 2, rarely is it 9. Right. It's always little kids.
Yeah, and that's where we really take the initial hits. That's where we begin to develop a defense, because until that time we didn't know we needed one. But it doesn't take more than a bully at school or a little bad parenting or even sibling rivalry. It's just amazing the variety of situations that can create the opportunity for a lot of misunderstanding and false assumptions. And yet, so much of that, like a silent tape loop running in the background, is at the root of why you feel the way you feel right now. And maybe you're acting out and somebody says, geez, you're acting like you're 7 years old or something. Well, maybe. Yeah,
maybe. And that's the kind of stuff we can deal with. I mean, stuff did happen before we were 2, you know, I mean, in early infancy, but that's real difficult to bring up. But really, somewhere around 4, 5, 6 is when we have our earliest childhood memories. And for most people, it's around there. And some of those are always tinged with the most negative experiences, the most powerful negative experiences we have. And regardless of how terrible or wonderful our parents were, they did some terrible and wonderful things, you know. So we have memories and we have experiences with them, with our peers, with each other, that we regret we did something, or we feel remorse that we did, or we feel embarrassed every time we're thinking about it, or ashamed of ourselves. All those kinds of feelings, they were appropriate at the time, but they still run us today. If we haven't let go of them.
When we think about the two parts of the self, the person we were then as the little child and the adult that we've become, that provides us with a context in which we can look at shame and guilt and embarrassment and humiliation from the point of view that you introduced us to a few minutes ago. Am I the shamed, the child that feels shame still and always right. will at the core of your being and is not going to go away, embarrassed or humiliated? Or are you the adult that you've become from a more mature perspective with much greater understanding and insight, and that means much more able to understand what happened to the kid, well, that adult, in a sense, can rescue that child.
Indeed.
And can bring them into the present. We can shift from identifying with the one that was hurt and feeling the shame to the one that says, but I'm acknowledging this shame, and I'm even understanding it at a level that allows me to forgive it, which means letting go of it. It's Indeed. Really a matter of perspective.
And we can do that because we're not the mind that of the child that feels the shame, nor are we the mind of the adult that we're directing to go heal the child. We're the awareness of the fact that both of those are within us. So we're the conductor of the play, and we're writing the play now that's saying, okay, you know that childhood pain we had, that humiliation, that embarrassment, that stuff that happened to us or that we did that we're embarrassed about. Yes, it happened. We'll always remember that it happened, but the emotions that were connected to it then are no longer appropriate for me to have now. Now what I want to feel is really proud of myself that I made it through that stuff and I'm the great and greater person that I am and am becoming. And so I want to trade the feelings I had then for the feelings I have now. How do you make that trade? The answer is really simple because the brain is really wired primitively about this. All you need to do is remember the feeling of being embarrassed or ashamed or what upset. Remember the feeling and then go, take a deep breath, a slow conscious deep breath, let it out, let your body relax as you let go of the breath, and then your brain now knows that that feeling is no longer dangerous to you. That feeling is now a feeling that can be released, it's safe, it doesn't have any danger. You don't have to be wary of that moment anymore, of hurting you anymore, because this time it didn't hurt you, this time you were able to feel safe with it, so therefore it's of no danger and we can relegate it out of this, the place of, you know, being a fearful thing and now into the place of being just a memory.
Yeah, in the vast majority of cases I've seen in 30, 35 years of practice, it's as simple as realizing and doing this again in what we call paradise thinking, in the alpha brainwave level, where you're really focused and feeling really, really safe, you bring the awareness of the mature adult you've become to this childhood hurt and pain. And inevitably, in the majority of cases, it's a matter of seeing that you were taking responsibility and blame for something that really wasn't your fault. Like, let's say dad yelled at you one day or mom said something that sort of cut the wrong way and felt sort of nasty and hurtful. And as a child, you know that's about you. They just said, you know, you're stupid or boy, what an idiot or why did you say that or whatever it was. And you take that on. You take ownership of it and you wear it and that's your hurt. But when you go back and revisit it, as Steve and I are talking about, this, the core of hypnotherapy and psychotherapy and so much spiritual healing work, to use the imagination in a reflective, relaxed kind of a state, allows you to recognize, in many cases right off the bat, you didn't do anything wrong. Your mom or dad were having the bad day. You know, they're the ones that put that on you. And you don't have to carry that around anymore. You can put that down now and stop carrying that hurt, that false belief, as easily as just recognizing it, provided we're in these paradise states.
Indeed. In this state, you can let go of the shame and the guilt that you don't even deserve to have. And maybe more significant, if you go a little later in your life, maybe into preteens and teenage days, maybe there's stuff you did that you really are ashamed of. I mean, stuff you really did, you know, that you, boy, you wish you had that one back or you wish you hadn't, you know. Those kinds of feelings, the guilt you have about those kinds of, those are healthy to have because you want to learn to not do those kinds of things again. That's why. But if you learned that, I mean, and you have proof that you haven't done it again, and now carrying that guilt is of no great value to you anymore. You already got what the guilt can teach you. So now, as an adult, you can actually let go of the feeling of guilt that you have about the things you actually did do that were bad and wrong and terrible and horrible. You can actually let go of the feeling of guilt, remember the event, and remember that you learned from having done those things not to do them again. But that's what the guilt was for, so it's done its job. You can feel the guilt and release it and replace it with the feeling of proud of yourself that you've made it through.
Boy, I'm glad you added that last bit, because that is the next step.
Yes.
And replace it with a positive feeling. In other words, imagine, as the adult you've become, hugging this child, embracing them, being like a big brother, a big sister, or even a parent, you know, just sort of a grown-up that's taking care of this little version of you and comforting as if this child has just had some bad nightmare or something, and all your job is simply comfort the child, tell him everything's okay, that we're here now, you're with me, you're safe. And believe it or not, that works, even though it's self-talk. It works incredibly. The benefits are extraordinary and proven, provided you do it in a state of focused passion, in what we call paradise thinking. If you do this in normal consciousness, with 8 or 10, 12 voices yelling at you, listen to me, easily distracted, your attention scattered, multitasking, as Steve often calls it, well, you're not going to get nearly the quality of benefit. I mean, don't even bother. You're just adding another voice to the chorus.
Really, maybe you'll listen to that one, maybe not. It's not, you know, not very likely that you will. What you really need to do is you need to get rid of all those other voices, and the way you do that is to simply close your eyes, take a deep breath, and go to this place inside called paradise. And when we're talking about paradise thinking, there's really a couple of different kinds. One is where you can sort of catch yourself going off into negative thoughts, you know, and the stream of consciousness goes by and you catch yourself having negative thoughts, bad feelings about the past and stuff, and you become conscious of the fact that you're like running this guilt trip on yourself or these negative tapes in your head. And paradise thinking is catching yourself at that and going, ah, boy, I'm glad I released that. And the other part of paradise thinking is the applied thought, the purposeful thought, the choosing to think in a positive way, choosing to create the consciousness of, I'm going to program my mind to do this. I'm going to allow myself to answer the question that I need to know about myself. You know, purposeful conscious thinking.
It's like receiving and sending.
Yeah, exactly.
I think that's a real important concept. I call a lot of the work that I did just a few years ago, meditative hypnosis, teaching as a career, those two things.
Yeah.
And a lot of meditators know nothing of hypnosis or even superstitious about it, and yet it's the same level of mind. And how many hypnotherapists would feel uncomfortable teaching meditation, and yet, again, the same level of mind? I think to consider that meditation essentially is a receptive state, as you said, and that self-hypnosis is just the opposite of that, the sending, you know, putting out, giving, and creating that magnetic field of attraction. That's
yeah.
The law of attraction, visualizing what you want as if you've already got it. Well, we can apply that, both of those, the receiving and the sending, to a process that allows you to rescue the little kid that's still inside you, wanting you to come and save him from these false assumptions and these bad memories, that, again, it's so easy to rescue them if you use this focused, passionate alpha brainwave state. I think a lot of it is just fully understanding the relationship of imagination and memory. And, Steve, when we remember this hurt, we're using the imagination.
Right. It no longer hurts, you know, in that you could remember a time when you broke your arm and that doesn't hurt now, right?
But you could remember the pain.
But you could remember the pain. Well, you remember the pain from being embarrassed or from being humiliated, but it still hurts. It still feels like the same kind of pain, but it doesn't need to.
It's funny. In some ways, memories of emotional pain hurt even more than memories of physical
pain.
Well,
they sure do last longer. I mean, yeah. If memories of physical pain lasted longer, women would never have more than one kid. But the fact is, the physical pain memory goes away.
I never would have climbed two mountains.
There you go. There you go. So we do have a tendency to hold on to the emotional pain even after we've long let go of the physical pain. Why is that? Well, because we healed ourselves of the physical pain, but we still haven't healed ourselves of the emotional pain. And what does it take to heal ourselves of the emotional pain? And it's simply a matter of forgiving ourselves for having done it.
Yeah. Understanding that in most cases, and you'll see it right away, you begin to do the process we're going to show you. And I'm really excited about it. Steve's got this great idea for a very, very special audio journey or guided imagery process at the last part of this program here today. So stay tuned for that. But it's just so exciting to know. And I've got to prove Steve and I both got 3 decades in this field. And psychotherapy goes back a while now. So there's plenty of evidence that people can go back. It's just surprising sometimes how really easy it is to say, well, hey, wait a minute. I mean, I can remember so clearly as a young man. And I can talk about my father this way because he died a long time ago. He would come home often so stressed out that, you know, the dog would run to greet him at the door and he'd kick the dog.
Ooh.
He'd yell at my mother. He'd push my brother out of the way and come after me. And I'm running looking for a place to hide. But I thought it was about me. Now, that's understandable, right?
He was running at you.
From all appearances, he's coming after me, right? And the people that preceded me didn't do very well, and now he's coming after me, and I got a history and reason to run and hide. Don't know why, but quite clearly, it's about me. And everybody listening right now knows exactly what I'm talking about. Because if it wasn't one of your parents, it might have been an older sibling, it could have been a bully up the block, it could have been a school teacher, a camp counselor, a bus driver, a stranger on the street that laughed at you, mocked you, pointed at some. I remember girls laughing at me in the first grade, Steve, because I had dirty fingernails.
Wow.
And I still remember that, but I let go of the pain using a process like this. And I said, well, I was 6 years old, and I had worms in my pocket and probably a frog in my book bag. And, yeah, of course I had dirt under my fingernails, you know.
So the memory remains, except now it brings you amusement. Now it brings you a feeling of joy to remember that being caught. Even though at the time it was humiliating, it was a horrible feeling. I mean, like really, really bad. You know, like put it in perspective. Remember how big we make things when we're 6 years old? When something bad happens, it's like our whole world. It's like there is no such thing as other countries or other. I mean, it's all about our little old world. And when something like that happens, it's huge.
And one of the girls I liked, you know, I don't know why, but I never thought girls had cooties.
Wow.
You know?
You escaped that.
I mean, I wasn't sexual about it. It was just, I don't know, sort of this hearts and flowers thing as 6 years old. So one of them I really liked. So, yeah, it was totally humiliating that she and her girlfriend were giggling and pointing at my fingernails and whispering and, you know, many, many years later. And yet, how many of these things happen to us and then we forget about them?
Yeah.
At least the conscious mind loses access. But they're still in there, running under the surface of conscious awareness, impacting us and adding, in a sense, the voice, a voice of that experience to the chorus of voices saying, you're bad, you're wrong, you're stupid, you're inadequate, you'll blow it. Even if you succeeded, you know you'd screw it up sooner or later. And, you know, a lot of this, Steve, I think is also going from mentally trying to figure out our hurt in a high-stress beta state, normal consciousness. I think a lot of the benefit of going to paradise and doing our thinking there is that it gets much more emotional.
Yeah.
And instead of just parsing things with our minds, deductively trying to take everything apart and figure out all the little pieces in our lives, just go more to the heart and let the heart lead you. You know, throw your heart over first and then follow that. That's the part that needs the healing. The mind, it learns very quickly. And says, oh, that was wrong. Oh, you made a mistake. No problem. Got it. Won't do that again. But the heart's going, whoa, wait a minute. I still retain the feeling. And I may always feel that way. No, you won't. No, you won't. You can fix your childhood. It's called inner child work, and it's never too late to have a happy child. You can be the parent that you always wanted. You can be the older brother or the big sister that comes to the rescue. You can be the friend up the block and do for yourself. When you access memory through imagination and then learn to really get into imagination, well, I mean, if memory is in imagination, then how else to fix it but to use the imagination, and how else to do that except alpha brain thinking, you know?
Indeed, this is the state that you need to be in to make this happen.
That's the, because we all think this stuff, but people say, well, what difference does it make? You're just talking to me. I've told that to myself 100 times. Alpha, paradise, expanded awareness that comes from feeling safe and relaxed is a very different place.
Indeed. It's the only thing your mind is doing. The subconscious mind does not know the difference between real and imaginary. It's really happening to your mind. So even though you have a real memory of this being embarrassing, you'll also have a just as real memory of being proud of yourself that you survived this embarrassing moment. Understand, no matter what it is that you are feeling from your past, and it's really only about two things. It's about other people or about you. You know, whatever it is about other people did to you or that you did that you're embarrassed about, whatever it is, that's not you. That's who you were. That's not you. The memory of those things needs to remain in your mind because you need to learn the lessons, and who you are is made up of all your memories. But the feelings that that child experienced do not need to remain inside of you.
That's it.
I mean, just like when you broke the arm, the pain that you had needed to be there while it was healing, but once it was healed, that pain could go away. Once you heal the childhood, that pain too can go away. And it all gets replaced with feeling proud of yourself that you survived all this stuff. I mean, you did. You're here. You made it through that childhood. You, no matter how wonderful most of it was and horrible some of it was, or no matter how horrible almost all of it was, you made it through. Right. You deserve to be proud.
Right. I am a survivor. You know, I'll never have to go through that again. And even if I get close, I'll see it coming a mile away.
And so every time you think about your childhood, you can remember every detail and just feel proud instead of all those other feelings of embarrassment and regret and remorse and shame and guilt and all that stuff. All that stuff, you can remember having felt it, but you don't need to any longer feel it if you replace it in the alpha brainwave state. It has to be done in focused passion. If you replace it in this state, you see, you have, let's say on a 1 to 10, you have an 8 on this emotion of this old memory of this guilt feeling, you know? Well, if you use your imagination and create an 8 experience of feeling proud of yourself of you know, now, then you've just canceled out the old feeling. Literally, your mind doesn't know the difference between that memory of then and this memory of a few minutes ago. If they're equally passionate, they'll cancel each other out.
You've said that twice, and I want to dwell on it a little more because it is so core to this whole process and why it works and the implications in everybody's lives in any and every state of mind, so huge that I really want to emphasize this, Steve, the idea that the imagination, the powerful subconscious mind, 90% or more of our hidden and untapped potential, is not like a backup will. It doesn't say, are you sure that's real? Or are you just pretending? It doesn't care. Look how easily you turn things over to imagination in a movie theater and without any effort at all are totally caught up in shadows on a wall as if they were real. And the conscious mind tells you at any point that you wish, hey, you're in a movie theater and it's projected from behind you on the screen and that's a reflection you're watching and it's just colored lights and it's really not even moving. It's 26 frames a second flashing by you. But what fun would that be? So we let that go and go right back into the imagination. It just doesn't care whether this is really happening or not. In the best sense of the word exploit, we can exploit that.
Yes. So, for example, the memories you have that of being mistreated or abused by a parent or a sibling or a person in your life, what you need to do is remember those feelings, go there, remember how those things felt, and let your brain know that they can't hurt you anymore by going, now I can feel those feelings and feel safe because I know those are the past, they're not now, I can feel safe. Those feelings don't make me go anymore. Now those feelings, I can go, and that's the core, that's the difference. Your brain, when it thinks of those feelings, it wants to tighten its muscles and hold its breath and run away. But now it knows it's in the past, it's no danger anymore. Now it can feel safe. So go explore those feelings, whatever pops up. Pick the word, embarrassment. Think of a moment that was embarrassing. I was 13 years old. I just finished being in Little League, and now I was the year after Little League, and my brother was still in Little League, and they asked me if I'd announce, you know, get up there and do the play-by-play announcing, you know, my first opportunity to get up in front of an audience, sort of like, and be a public speaker in a way, although I'd done a few speeches in school, but this was like, you know, hundreds of people, and they came up and said, Steve, tell them that the raffle tickets are available for sale at the concession stand, and I said, the raffle tickets are available at the student store, and I... Oops. And I was so embarrassed. I like put my hands on my head and I crawled around like I'd made the worst mistake in the world. Well, now I can remember in that moment. It was horrible. Like I wanted to die. Now I remember that moment because I've been through this process with it with a lot of amusement and, you know, like, you know, come on. How bad was it? It was horrible, but how bad was it, really?
But unless and until we use the alpha brainwave state, what we call paradise, a state of focused passion, it's just another thought inside your head. You need the focus and you need the passion of a meditative, contemplative state of mind. And please understand that that's one of the essential bits, what we hammer at home all the time. It's so key to personal empowerment, and it's missing in a lot of the personal empowerment programs. They're talking at you and they're telling you how to be and what you should be and how to think and how to feel, teaching and instructing, and all of that is wonderful and valuable. You should see our bookshelves. And yet, if they're not teaching you how to go to paradise, how to access what a brain researcher and scientist would call the alpha brainwave level, 10 cycles plus or minus a few, if you're not going to this meditative, safe, relaxed place of focused passion, then you're just going to keep talking to yourself. And if you use the exercise that follows pretty quickly here, and if you do it a second time and maybe even a third time, you'll know the difference that it makes. You'll experience it. It'll completely change your life when you do this kind of inner child work.
Indeed. I mean, you may hear the words, but it's like having the right channel but not having the volume knob. The alpha's the volume knob, you know. This is what makes it important to the mind. You got to add the passion and the focus together to make the mind think this is really, really important. If it's just one of a bunch of voices going on, then it's not that important to the mind. If the emotion level's not that high, then it's not that important to the mind. We're going to do something right now that the mind is going to find incredibly important, and this is an opportunity. We're going to do something real different. Michael alluded to the fact we've got a different kind of ending for you today. And this is an audio journey, a guided imagery, if you will, that's not going to be typical because we're not going to, like, wake you up from this one. This is, in fact, designed to be a bedtime story. Right. And this is something you can play over and over and over again. Instead, perhaps, of the 11 o'clock news, you can take these 10 or 15 minutes and listen to this bedtime story about how this wonderful, wonderful adult healed this child and woke up the next morning feeling happier and healthier and more fulfilled and more confident and more powerful. Every morning that they listen to this before they go to bed, they wake up in the morning. What a wonderful story this is. A story about you recreating the passion that your childhood could have had.
So understanding even the closing theme of this program will leave off. And you may need to turn off your player and maybe it shuts itself off depending on how you set it. But the idea is to use, unlike all the other ones we've done, or most of the other ones, is to use this to go to sleep at night and to go through extremely powerful levels of relaxation on the way, where we're more open, much more receptive to understanding, to insight, to an awareness of why you should forgive yourself. And maybe forgive some other people too. And maybe even forgiveness is not even a matter of self or others, but something even more. And so if this is an appropriate time for you, take a nice, slow, deep breath, filling your lungs with strength and power. Hold as you peak. Exhale just as slowly. And begin to create and sense a feeling of relaxation.
And whether you're listening to this now as the end of this experience the first time, or playing this again as a bedtime story, now's the time, with your eyes closed, having taken a deep breath or two, to begin to feel nice as you find yourself in paradise. And with every breath you release, you feel more peace. And with every moment that goes by, you find your mind unwind. You find your mind unwind.
Always so safe here, so peaceful, feeling in your body, so relaxed, feeling the safety and the peace now. And this is like your home base for the experience. At any time you wish, you can easily recall the feeling of being safe and relaxed in this beautiful paradise, however you conceive it, wherever you consider it to be, in Eden, a place of perfect peace, a place you can return to in an instant, at any time you wish, to remember just how safe you are right now.
It's a great place to keep clear in your mind. Because any time you want to, you can always find you can return here and be clear. And if this place you keep, you can also use it as a dropping off point to fall asleep. So, with that thought in mind, that this time you find it's time to go to bed, you lay your pillow down and put it just right underneath your head, and what comes to your mind are thoughts of the past, things of long ago. And when the sad or embarrassing or shameful ones emerge, you're safe, so you can just let them go. Feel them emerge, sometimes in a surge, sometimes just one here and there. But whenever they appear, it's abundantly clear that you're able to release them somewhere. They just go away. They just release. And you are replacing them with a feeling of peace. And you feel yourself move closer to sleep. Closer and closer to sleep.
Allowing yourself to remember, to create not only in your mind's eye, but a feeling in your body of what it was like to be 5 or 6 years old, maybe 4, maybe 7, somewhere in there. Think of all the joy, how spontaneous it was, times that you were happy and happy for no reason at all, just to be, to have a life. But there were other times. Times that you felt bad about yourself, you felt sad. Face those, allow those to bubble up. Like bubbles effervescing, coming up and out. Feel them, identify them. Breathe and let go.
Release. Feel the peace.
Imagine playing. The adult that you've become with the child you are at this age.
Release. Feel the peace.
Dancing and playing as if the adult part of you is the best friend the child part of you ever could have asked for. Like a big brother or this idyllic parent or the best, most trusted friend in the world.
And together, you heal. And you remember what occurred. Your mind, rest assured, it will always recall. But the feelings grow small.
smaller and smaller, fading away. The negative feelings from then, they don't make it today. Instead, there's a feeling growing now deep inside, a feeling you're feeling, a feeling of pride, pride that you made it, pride you survived, pride that you made it, pride that you thrived. All those old feelings you used to hold, now you can release and feel the pride deep inside, accompanied by inner peace. And every night when you lay down and it's time to go to sleep, in your mind you'll always find this feeling that you keep, the feeling of pride that's growing inside as you release what was painful before. The pain fades away, and the pride's here to stay. In fact, the pride feels like even more. You're proud of yourself, and yet you remain humble and clear that the pride that you feel is just releasing the fear and forgiving yourself for what's no longer here. What's no longer here is that pain. What's here is you. And you can re-explain with the wisdom of the adult teaching the child.
And finally, consider for those memories that seem to you to be most hurtful and involving what you may see as abusive behavior at the hands of another. You may wish to imagine that you are able to freeze the abuser in space and time, like you have a remote control and you hit pause. And with that control, you pause them long enough to tell them what you're doing. That you're rescuing the child you are at this young age from the false assumptions they made as a result of this behavior. Know that you do not need apologies. You do not need this person to be aware of this process. They need not even be alive any longer for you to forgive. Simple understanding and a willingness to let it all go, to put it down. You don't need to forget. You can forgive and learn and understand, and move from anger to compassion, and a quality of forgiveness that is not about forgiving the other and or forgiving yourself, but a forgiveness that includes all of that. I understand it now. I can put it down.
And so every time you fall asleep, forgiveness is in your mind. Every time you fall asleep, more forgiveness for yourself you find. And you listen to this journey. You listen to this play.
Feel the letting go.
And every time you listen, you forgive yourself this way.
Just drop it.
It's a bedtime story. It's a happy ever after. It's a wonderful way to sleep. Allow our voices to take you, oh so deep, toward sleep.
Peaceful, natural, healthy sleep. And sweet dreams.
Sweet dreams, and allow the sleep to heal. Good night.
Take your child with you. See you tomorrow. Good night.